Good morning. Let's stand together and let's worship the Lord today. This is the day the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and let's be glad in it. If you're joining us online, we are glad that you've joined us at Cornerstone Church. Sing with us as we study God's word. He is worthy, 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 worthy of our praise. Amen.
This day we're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens. We want to see you open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart. Lord, you're filling every part of our praise.
Yeah. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Your presence in this place. Your glory's on our face. We're looking to the skies. Descending like a cloud. Lord, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. And you're the reason we're singing. Oh, open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart. You're filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart. You're filling every part of our praise. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us, Lord, your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. To see you open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart. Lord, you're filling every part of our praise. Oh, say it again. Lord, open up the heavens. We want to see you open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise. Show us your power, oh, show us your glory, Lord, oh, yes, show us, Lord, show us your glory, yes, show us your power, oh, show us your glory, Lord,
oh, make yourself known unto us, God.
Show us your glory, oh, show us your power, oh, show us your glory, Lord,
oh, make it your prayer, pray it to him one more time, Lord,
show us your glory, show us your power, oh, show us your glory, Lord.
Give him praise, give him glory. Amen. 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 Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet, for He has done great things. Amen. Amen. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, You conquer. Your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, Your name lifted high. Oh, God, You have done great things. You've been faithful through every storm. Amen. You'll be faithful forever.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning as we continue to worship Him. Lord Jesus, we are so grateful and thankful that we can come to this place. Lord, gather in Your name and worship You. Lord, we're so thankful, Lord, that although it may be hot outside and us experiencing extreme temperature, Lord, here in Texas, Lord, that Lord Jesus, we're thankful to know that because of our salvation, we don't have to endure this heat for eternity. Amen. Amen. We thank You this morning, Lord, for the relationship that we can have to God the Father through Jesus, His Son. And Lord, we pray this morning in agreement as a church that if there'd be any man, woman, boy, or girl that may be here that doesn't have a personal relationship with Jesus, that today will be the day that they will enter into a relationship with You. Lord, we pray now that as we sing and as our praises to You go up, Lord, that Your Holy Spirit, He will come down and He will fill this place and minister to the hearts and lives of those that are here. Lord, we love You today. We thank You, Lord Jesus, and we need You. It's in Your name we pray. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. As we continue to worship Him this morning, you remember the breath that we breathe is a gift from the Lord. The salvation that we experience is a gift from the Lord. The only thing that we can give back unto Him that He has not already given unto us is our worship. And so worship Him this morning unashamedly. He was crucified for you.
declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And know these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword. Still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. If your voice is the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation. Days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest.
Oh, the fields are as white in your
Jehovah. There's no God like 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 Jehovah. Yeah. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, and shining like the sun at the trumpet call. If your voice is the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, and shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation.
His praises. One day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men. My example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined among us. His glory revealed, living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, oh, rising he justified freely forever, one day he's coming, oh, glorious day.
out on a tree and took the nails for me. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sin far away. And rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day.
Conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose over death he had conquered. Now he's ascended, my Lord, evermore. Death could not hold him. The grave could not keep him. Rising again, living he loved me, and dying he saved me, and buried he carried my sin far away, and dying he justified, oh freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day. Glorious day, glorious day. One day the trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glories will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved. Freely forever, and one day he's coming. Oh, glorious day! Oh, glorious day! Glorious day! Oh, glorious day!
Give the Lord praise.
Our love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Oh, great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour. Your breath in our lungs,
earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing for praise.
Brother Jim. Bible school. Praise the Lord. We got another week to get everybody signed up. If you hadn't signed up to serve, be sure to, there's a booth out in the front. Brother Randy Sandy will be there. What a blessing to be able to serve in Vacation Bible School. Amen. If you have your Bibles this morning, please turn with me to 1 Thessalonians and 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Thessalonians and 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We welcome you all here this morning. Our children's church is on their way out to worship, and they'll have a wonderful time. Good to see everybody here. Those are online. We welcome you all over America who are watching our services. We hope that you'll be able to download the outline and follow along with us this morning as well. Anybody need an outline? Everybody got an outline? We got one right up here. Guys, we need some help. Right here. Raise your hand, Deb. Oh, you got one, okay. Anybody else? Praise the Lord. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and 1 Corinthians 15. We got baptism this morning, so that's a praise the Lord. We had a wonderful youth camp. Thank God for all of our counselors and young people that got to go to Lake Levan. Had 4 young people saved, so that's a praise the Lord. So a wonderful time at youth camp, and
We'll look forward to seeing those young people coming to be baptized here in a few weeks. Somebody put a Gunsmoke movie collection on my deal. Whose is this? Gunsmoke collection? Oh, thank you. We'll take this on our trip tomorrow. Yeah, my wife would be thrilled, I mean. But anyway, praise the Lord. Thank you. Thank you for ever remembering me that. But anyway, guys, let me tell you, you know, we've been studying on the life of Elijah. And a man for the hour. It's a man that we need to be studying, especially right now in America. Because God used one man to turn a nation around. Amen. And God can use one to do the same for America. It's good to see Tommy and Mary Nance that just walked in. Good to see y'all, Brother Tommy. Love y'all. He always likes to make a big entrance. But anyway, when we get back from our vacation, we're going to be looking at a message that's strictly for America today. As we all know, guys, evil is rampant. It's part of the signs of the time. We don't like it, but it's just the way it is. And it's not going to get better, the Bible says. Many times we see what's going on, not only throughout our world, but the land that we love here in America. And we wonder, Lord, when are you going to do something about it? And in the book of Revelation, even the martyrs are crying out to God saying, when will you revenge our death? When will you repay all this evil? And I can promise you this, folks, that one of these days, all the injustices that we see across our country today will meet their master. One of these days, all the injustices that we see in this nation today is going to meet their master when Jesus comes again. Getting back to Elijah, a king tried to take a man's property from him that did not belong to him. And God used Elijah to straighten that all out. About Ahab and a farmer, and Ahab and his queen, Ahab and Elijah, then Ahab meets God, and it's not good. And one of these days, evil is going to meet the God of heaven. That's going to happen, folks. But with that in mind, this morning, I'm going to begin with a song. I had a funeral yesterday. Brother Tommy and Mary Nance was there. For a man who won 3 bronze stars in World War II. 3 bronze stars. Amen. Who was shot down over in Germany. It was a POW. Several Purple Hearts. And more medals that we could count. He was a bomber on the B-17 Flying Fortress during World War II. A part of America's greatest generation. Heaven, all of you know this, and some of you know it better than others. But heaven keeps getting sweeter every day. There's really a lot of homesickness for God's people to be home one of these days. And it won't be long. But I want you to hear a song that I play on my CD almost every day. You got your favorites, and we all got our favorites. And it's going to be an introduction to this message this morning on the great getting up morning when Jesus comes. And We can't wait till that happens.
We read of a place that's called heaven.
Turn it up, brother.
It's made for the pure and the free. These truths in God's word He has given. How beautiful heaven must be. So sweetly are singing. Betrayals and failures destroy. All pain and all suffering for God ten. And all tears will turned into joy. How beautiful heaven must be. Sweet home of the happy and free. Will play without sadness. The women will dance without fear. The men will walk tall with
Thessalonians chapter 4, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. If you got it, say you got it. Let's stand in honor of God's word together. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, then we'll be going to 1 Corinthians 15 on that great getting up morning. Verses we're all familiar with. But verses in times like this we keep coming back to. Beginning in verse 16, 1 Thessalonians 4. For the Lord Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Every head bowed, every eye closed, those here at Cornerstone and those who are watching at home, would you join with us this morning as we all pray together? Dear Jesus, please speak to my heart today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated, church. When Jesus comes again, according to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, three things are going to happen. Would you write down, number one, the word return? Write down the word return. Because when Jesus comes at the rapture, which could take place at any moment, Jesus is coming with a shout. It's interesting when you study the scriptures. The Bible says that Jesus shouted three times in the New Testament. The first time he shouted, fill in the out, and you're at blanks in the outline, Jesus shouted three times in the scriptures. He shouted first time at a cemetery. Y'all remember the story in John chapter 11. He said, Lazarus, come forth. I need some help, please. One of these days, he's going to do that again. He's going to say, my children, come forth. But he shouted at a cemetery. Number two, he shouted on a cross when he cried in John chapter 19, it is finished. And Jesus was the one sacrifice for sin forever. The third time, the Bible says Jesus was shouting not only at a cemetery, not only on the cross, but one of these days he's going to shout in the clouds because he's coming back in a cloud. When he comes to take his children home. I got a text from some of you this week, Randy Fletcher, who's with our children, been preaching on Elijah in that cloud like the size of a man's hand. And I got a text from Randy this week, sent me a picture, and there was a cloud way up in the sky about the size of a man's hand. Every morning during the day, I look for those clouds because those clouds tell me one of these days Jesus is coming back in one of them clouds. That's why you need to practice his presence, ponder his precepts. They're all around us. But guys, let me tell you, that's why we need to be looking to the skies and listening for a shout. For when Jesus comes, he's going to shout. I always wondered why he's going to shout when he comes again. Then after pastoring a Baptist church for 55 years, I finally figured it out. He's going to wake up all those Baptists who have been sleeping all these years. The preacher can't wake you up, but I guarantee you one of these days Jesus will wake you up. When Jesus comes again, write down the word return. Secondly, write down the word rapture. The word rapture means caught up. Look at verse 16 with me, and the key phrase is in Christ. For the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 4:16, when Jesus comes at the rapture, he's only coming for believers only, for those who've been saved, born again. And it says in 1 Thessalonians 4:16, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ. Would you underscore that phrase, ma'am? Only those who are in Christ will be caught up at the rapture. Say amen to that. At the rapture, which could take place at any moment, he's not coming back for unbelievers. He's coming back for those who are in Christ, those who've been born of the Spirit of God, washed in the blood of the Lamb. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Thirdly, when he comes again, write down the word reunion. Reunion. For one of these days, we're all going to be together again. We're separated for a short time, but thank God we don't have to say goodbye to our loved ones. Look at verse 17 again. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 17. There's going to be a reunion one of these days. Then they which are alive and remain shall be caught up together. We'll be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Look at verse 18. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. When a Christian dies, fill in the blanks, their body goes to the grave, but their spirit goes immediately to glory land. Go to heaven. Say amen to that, guys. Never buried a Christian. You don't bury Christians. You bury the old house they used to live in. Say amen to that. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5:8, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the Bible tells us what's going to happen on that great getting up morning. You say, well, Brother Jim, how do you know he's coming back in the morning? I can tell you this, it's going to be morning somewhere. Can I have some help, please? It's going to be morning somewhere. For half the world is asleep, the other half is awake. So if he comes back at midnight here, it's going to be 12 noon on the other side. So he's coming back in the morning, whether it's here or there. But 1 Corinthians 15, I want you to turn to 1 Corinthians 15. Because the Bible tells us what it's going to be like on that great getting up morning when Jesus comes again. Every one of you here, Brother Joe Stepp, you got a daddy that's there now. Every one of us here have someone we love that's with Jesus. Can I see a hand? Do you have anybody in heaven? Let me tell you, guys, then you need to listen to this message. The Bible tells us what's going to happen when Jesus comes again at that great getting up morning. I'm going to give you six words that start with the letter I. That tells us what's going to happen when the dead in Christ are raised. What's it going to be like? Number one, if you're taking notes, write down the word illustration. Write down the word illustration. And look with me, please, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning with verse 35. An illustration. Those old bodies of our loved ones, what are they going to look like when the dead in Christ rise forth? 1 Corinthians 15, 35. But some men say, well, how are the dead raised up? How are the dead going to be raised up? And with what body will they come? Thou fool, that which thou sowest is not made alive except it die. And that which thou sowest not thy body that shall be, but bare grain or seed. It may chance of wheat or some other grain. People ask the question, how are the dead going to be raised up? And the Bible says, I want to give everyone an illustration. Fill in the blanks. The Bible says it's like a seed. Those loved ones will be buried in that cemetery. Those old bodies, they're like a seed planted in the ground. That seed seems to die and to disintegrate. But out of that dead seed comes life and a glorious new form when Jesus comes again. Jason, would you raise your hand? I mentioned him Wednesday night. He's got a garden. Sylvia, let me do the preaching, please. He's got a sunflower tree that's purple. I've never seen a sunflower tree 8 foot tall. We got sunflower trees, but they're not purple. 99% of you have never seen a purple sunflower tree. Never seen one in my life. He has a home in Thailand. He travels all over the world working. He's got a home in Thailand. He's fixing to go back in a few months. I buried his daddy not too long ago. And every time I go see Jason and Sylvia, I see that purple sunflower tree. Another day I said, I want a seed of that purple sunflower tree. So he gave me the big flower. And I plucked one seed. Here it is. Here's one seed of that 8 foot tall purple sunflower. Are y'all listening? That does not look like an 8-foot sunflower tree. Does that look like an 8-foot purple? The seed's black. But you know what? You plant this in the ground. You know what it does? It decays and it dies, and don't be long till out pops a purple sunflower tree. Are you with me, please? I planted my daddy in the ground. I planted my mama in the ground. I planted my father-in-law on the ground. I planted my mother-in-law on the ground. I planted my big brother in the ground. I planted my 28-year-old daughter in the ground. I buried a lot of your family members in the ground. Guess what? They're like a seed. You place that body in the ground, and it seems to decay, and it's going to turn to dust. But here's the good news. When Jesus comes, out of that seed's coming a glorious new body. And my mama won't be crippled anymore. How are they going to be? How are the dead going to be raised? It's just like this seed. You can't tell me this is a purple sunflower tree until it comes up out of the ground. I thank God that those old bodies of our loved ones and friends have had 1,700 funerals, so I buried a few people. But those old bodies are like a seed. And when Jesus comes forth, they're going to be a glorious new body. No more cancer. No more COVID. Killed your daddy. That great getting up morning. The dead in Christ, John, shall rise first. And those old bodies out there, it's like this seed. Woo. One of these mornings, on that great getting up morning. Write down number two, the word identity. Write down the word identity. By the way, I'm selling these seeds if y'all want some. Oh, not really. Jason, I'm going to have you come and plant them because everything Kathy and I plant dies. So I'll let you come and plant them at our house. But guys, every big question about heaven is this. Will we know one another? We know that. A lot of people don't, because that's one of the questions I've been asked more times than any other. Will I know my mother? By the way, we're going to plant a seed in the ground Tuesday, aren't we? Roger, is that right? We're planting a seed. We see his mother. We're planting his mother a seed in the ground Tuesday at the National Cemetery where she's going to be buried Tuesday. His mother. We're going to plant a seed Tuesday. We already know how it's going to turn out when Jesus comes. Ain't no grave going to keep your mama down. But the question people ask, will we know one another in heaven? I don't want you to turn to Luke chapter 9 because I'll lose some of you. You won't ever get back to 1 Corinthians 15. And Kathy and I are leaving in the morning on our trip. So I want you to just stay put, but you can read those scriptures. But look up here. Luke chapter 9 is a story of Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. How many remembers that story? Well, that's sad. The Bible says that Jesus, and when you go to Israel with us, you get to go to that mountain, don't they, Brian? You get to go on that mountain where Jesus transfigured. You go to Israel with us next year, if Jesus tarries, you'll be going to that mountain. But on the Mount of Transfiguration, you remember the story. Jesus was transfigured on that mountain, and Moses and Elijah showed up. Y'all remember that story now? Oh, he took Peter, James, and John with him. But once he got to that mountain and was transfigured, Moses and Elijah was there. If you fill in the blanks in your outline, the transfiguration is a miniature heaven. It's like looking what heaven is going to be like when you read the story of the Mount of Transfiguration. It's a picture of heaven in miniature. It's interesting when you read that story. Look up here, church. Moses and Elijah and Jesus were all transfigured. They were all glorified, but yet they all kept their same identity. I need some help, please. See, you got to understand this. You see, that's a picture of what it's going to be. It's heaven in miniature. On the Mount of Transfiguration, Jesus was transfigured and glorified. Moses and Elijah was transfigured and glorified with Jesus. But guess, here's the good news. Moses was still Moses. Elijah was still Elijah. And Jesus was still Jesus. And yes, we will know one another in heaven. You need to say amen to that, Brother Paul. I'm looking forward to seeing my mother again, okay? And she's not my birthing parent. Wow, what a bunch of junk. My mother will be my mother, not my birthing parent, when I get to heaven. You bunch of rotten liberals. Bunch of rotten woke generation. Trying to tell our children that we can't say mother in school anymore. That's from hell. I've got a mother waiting on me in heaven. Not my birthing parent. Some of you don't like that, but you know what? Young people need to hear the truth. But that's coming into our public schools now. They're trying to shove it down our throats. Can't use the word mother anymore. May offend somebody. Well, it's time we offend somebody. And I want you to know, young lady, you're coming to church. You're going to hear the truth, whether you like it or not. That's why we live in a free country, so you can leave, never coming back again. But when you come here, you're going to hear the truth. I could care less. Mother. I could see my daddy and mother in heaven right now, me walk up and say, Dad, it's sure good to see my birthing parent. There's not supposed to be any violence in heaven. But if anybody could get knocked out, I'd got knocked out. That's your mother, boy. Aren't you glad on that great getting up morning we'll know one another? Amen. Illustration, identity, and this is my favorite. Write down the word improvement. Amen. There's going to be an improvement when Jesus comes at that great getting up morning. A big time improvement from what it is right now. Say amen to that. Look at 1 Corinthians 15, beginning with verse 42. When Jesus comes at that great getting up morning, there's going to be a vast improvement in your body and mind. Say amen to that. Look at verse 42. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption, but it's raised in incorruption. It's sown in dishonor, but it's going to be raised in glory. Now, as I look out across this auditorium, I don't see a whole lot of glory this morning. And I'm talking about me first. But one of these days, there's going to be a whole lot of glory. Old bodies, it says there in verse 43, it was sown in dishonor, but it's going to be raised in glory. It's sown in weakness, it'll be raised in power. It's been sown a natural body. That's what we're living in right now. This is a natural body. But when Jesus comes, it's going to be raised up a spiritual body. There's a natural body, and there's a spiritual body. Friends, on that great getting up morning, these new bodies that we'll have won't be marred and scarred by sin or sickness, or suffering, or old age. These old bodies that were sown in corruption are going to be raised in incorruption. These old bodies that were sown in weakness, one of these days are going to be raised in power. As a matter of fact, when we get there, heaven, our bodies will no longer be plagued by the four B's. I'm going to give you a fifth one that's not in your outline. But these new bodies will not be plagued by the four B's that we're plagued with here. Number one, we're not going to be plagued by bifocals. Amen. Can I have some help, please? You won't be plagued with baldness anymore, Chris. I'll recognize you. You'll finally have hair again. We're not going to be plagued anymore with bifocals, baldness, or bunions. A lot of these kids have no idea what bunions are, but wait till you get old and start wearing, your feet start wearing out. But I got good news for you, Tommy Nance. I told this to you yesterday. In heaven, no more bifocals, baldness, bunions, or bulges. Amen. That slim look you used to have. I just thought about this as I was preparing this message. There's another 4B we won't be plagued with either. It's called Biden. Woo! 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 Can I have some help, please? I don't like what he's doing to my country. I hope that offends somebody. He's destroying our nation morally and spiritually. We won't be plagued by him anymore. Or the rest of the woke generation trying to destroy this country morally and spiritually. I can't hardly wait. On that great getting up morning, these old bodies are going to have the ultimate makeover. And as I look at me and as I look at some of you, a lot of us here need some improvement. But guess what? It's coming one of these days. On that great getting up morning, what's it going to be like? Illustration, identity, improvement. Number 4, write down the word image. Image. Because people really want to know, Brother Jim, what are these bodies really going to look like? What are they really going to be? You're talking about a seed and all that. I'm getting a handle on that. But really, what are these old bodies really going to look like? Well, I want you to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15 with me. Look at verses 47 through 49. 47 through 49. And so it's written, the first man, Adam, that was Adam and Eve, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. And the last Adam was made a quickening spirit. You see, Jesus is called the second Adam. I want to read that again. We're all made in the image of Adam, our father. Are y'all out there, please? Our parents were Adam and Eve. Are y'all out there, please? That was our image. We were made in the image of Adam and Eve, our parents, the first Adam. Look what it says. So it's written, the first man, Adam, was a living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit. Howbeit that was not first, which is spiritual, but that which is natural. Talking about Adam, it was natural. And afterward, that which is spiritual. Jesus was spiritual. Say amen to that. The first man of the earth, earthy. That was Adam in the Garden of Eden. The second Adam, man, is the Lord from heaven. As the earthly, such as they also that are earthly, and as the heavenly, such as also those that are heavenly. Fill in the blanks. One of these days, right now, we're made in the image of Adam. Write it down. We're made in the image of Adam and Eve. We're made in the image of Adam and Eve. But when Jesus comes, we're going to be made in the image of Jesus. The Bible says in your outline, look at what it says about when Jesus comes. This is so good, guys. It says in 1 John 3:2, Beloved, now we're the children of God, and it's not yet been revealed what we shall be. What are we going to be like? But we know that when He is revealed, that's Jesus, we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. One of these mornings, on that great getting up morning, we're going to be like Jesus. So may I ask you to do something for me, please? Please be patient with me, because God's not finished with me yet. And guess what? I'll be patient with you because you're not finished here. He's not finished with you either. Amen. Well, Lynn, what's it going to be like? It's an illustration. It's identity, improvement, image. Write down the fifth word, immortality. Amen. Immortality. You see, these bodies were born to die. Say amen to that, guys. Every one of us here, if Jesus tarries, you know what we got in common? We're all going to die. Say amen to that. If Jesus tarries, we're all going to die here. But when Jesus comes again at the rapture, some of us will never die of physical death because we'll be caught up to meet Jesus in the air. Say amen to that. But if Jesus tarries, we're all going to die. We were born to die. Jesus Christ was born to die. Do you understand that? He wasn't born to live. He came to die for your sins and mine. He came to die. We dropped it. We don't live this. He only lived 33 years. If he was born to die, you and I are born to die. But you know what? When Jesus comes again, these old bodies are going to be made eternal. Say amen to that. They'll never die again. Look at verses 54 through 57. This is the word of God, and I'm grateful his word will never return to him void. As I speak these words, it's going out all over America. And whether you receive it or not, I can promise you this, God's word will not return to him void. And God's word says this in verse 54, so when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal, that's our bodies, put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. These bodies were sown immortality, but they'll be raised up in immortality, to never die again. Fill in the blanks. Praise God, Jesus takes the sting out of sin. He takes the sting out of sin. He takes the gloom out of the grave. It don't mean we don't weep. I wept yesterday at that man's funeral. I didn't know him like I know many of you, but I wept because I loved that man. Tears are just part of this life. But let me tell you, friends, I don't weep like you don't weep for those who have no hope. We weep because our joy is going to turn, our weeping is going to turn to joy when Jesus comes again. Because Jesus, on the cross, by virtue of his death, burial, and resurrection, he takes the sting out of sin. He takes the gloom out of the grave. And he takes the pain out of parting. Because we'll see our loved ones again. Never say goodbye. I've seen people walk by a casket and say, God, bye, Dad, bye, Mom. If you're a believer and they're a believer, you don't ever have to say goodbye, goofus. Only lost people say goodbye to their loved ones. We don't say goodbye. It's just till we meet again. That's the difference Jesus Christ makes in our lives. Right now, in one last word, and it's the word invitation. The invitation. Everyone say invitation. God's words mentions, look up here, church, two resurrections. The first resurrection, look up here, is for believers only. Those who've died in Christ, at the rapture, the dead in Christ shall rise first. That's the first resurrection. Say amen to that. That's going to happen when Jesus comes again. The dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive shall be caught up together with him in the clouds. Look what the Bible says about the first resurrection in Revelation. Look what it says, Revelation 26. Blessed and holy are those who have part of the first resurrection. Resurrection is for believers only. The first resurrection is for believers only when Jesus comes again. All of us who have loved ones who've gone on before, and that seed's been planted somewhere in some cemetery or some place that you place those ashes, wherever they may be. When Jesus comes again, the first resurrection, the dead in Christ shall rise first. And we're going to spend eternity with Jesus in heaven. Blessed are those who are part of the first resurrection. I saw a tomb one time, a grave one time. I can't even remember where. But it didn't mean a whole lot to me because I was a whole lot younger and a whole lot dumber then. But on that grave, it said, the scripture was Revelation 26, and in bold print, it had part of the first resurrection. Amen. That's pretty good. Whoever was buried there, their loved ones wanted everybody to know that they were going to be a part of the first resurrection. I'd never seen that before in my life. But we could put that on all of our tombstones of our loved ones who have gone to be with Jesus. They're going to be a part of the first resurrection. But the Bible mentions a second resurrection. Everybody look up here. You don't have to write anything down. I want everybody to look up here. The Bible mentions a second resurrection, and it's for unbelievers only. It's for those who've never been saved. It's for those, are you listening to me this morning? It's for those whose names have never been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And the second resurrection is going to take place at the great white throne judgment in Revelation chapter 20, verses 11 through 15. When God will bring those who rejected Christ out of their graves, and they'll stand before Jesus at the great white throne judgment. Be interesting if you and I was in a cemetery today and Jesus were to come and we're believers. There's going to be a whole lot of shaking going on. There's going to be a whole lot of bodies coming out of those, a lot of seeds coming out of those, but there's going to be a whole lot left. There's going to be more left than it's raised up. Are you out there, please? Those people never been saved, their body's going to stay in that ground until the second resurrection. And that's a resurrection for those who've aimed the gun at unbelief at Jesus and said, I don't need you. Like some of you here. You claim to be a believer. Where's the change in your life? You claim to be a believer in Christ, but you never made a commitment to Jesus in here. Those who are raised at the second resurrection, look up here, my friends, will spend forever in a place called hell. But you see, that choice is yours. That's why we give an invitation. Amen. Clear and simple. We gave an invitation yesterday at that funeral. Six people got saved for the glory of God. Amen. I talked about that World War II hero. Had a lady, first time it's ever happened to me, Brian. One of the ladies, never met her before in my life. I showed Kathy when I got home. She said, would you send me the outline of that message? And I texted her the outline that God gave to me for that great American. And I had 4 points. The Bible said about Abner, King David's friend. Abner was the commander-in-chief of King Saul's army. And King David loved Abner. And when Abner died, King David said this about his friend. Do you not know that a great man has fallen in Israel today? I shared at that service yesterday. Do you not know that on May 12th, 2022, that a great American passed away? Then I gave 4 reasons why that man of America's greatest generation, why I could call him great. He was great in his character, great in his courage and love for America. He was great in his commitment to his family. And most importantly, he was great in his choice he made for Jesus. That will preach, my friend. He made a great choice. He made a great choice. And he went from being a good man to God's man. Because he made the right choice. There's some of you here. You've never made that choice. There's no telling how many people in America watching over this. My wife went to a shower yesterday in Rockwall, and three people said, we watch the services every Sunday. People all over. We don't know how many's watching, but thank God we're grateful you're watching, folks. But there's some of you at home today. You need to make the right choice. Eternity's too long to be wrong. If you're not sure you ever made that commitment here, don't tell me about your Catholic persuasion, your Baptist persuasion. All of that, that don't have nothing to do where you spend eternity. You have to have Jesus here. Amen. I can't plead with you more than I'm doing right now to make the right choice. To say yes to Jesus. And you'll be a part of that great getting up morning. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Every head bowed and every eye closed. As Christians, we got a lot to be thankful for that our loved ones are with Jesus. And we know one of these days those old bodies are going to be like a seed. They're going to come forth a glorious new body. There's some here in this service, as my wife begins to play, and Becky, that you've never made that choice. Oh, you believe in Jesus. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir, at home. Yes, you believe in Jesus. The Bible says the demons believe in Jesus too. To make the right choice is to realize you're a sinner in need of a Savior and to open up your heart and invite Jesus in. And guess what? Today on July 10th, 2022, that can be your day. Romans 10:9 says, if you'll confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, if you believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you can be saved today, my friend, at home here at Cornerstone. Please, you're not here by accident. And if you're not sure, you need to be sure. God's Holy Spirit spoke into your heart. You'd like to make that commitment to him today. As I pray this prayer out loud, I'm going to ask you to pray this prayer silently in your heart to Jesus. You're not praying it to anyone but to him. But today, this can be your choice, your commitment. Would you pray this prayer this morning with me at home, here at Cornerstone? Would you simply pray, dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Without you, I know I'm lost. But today, dear Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of all my sins. And right now, Lord Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart and be my Lord and my Savior. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving my soul. In Jesus' name. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. All over this auditorium at home, if you prayed that prayer, there's a number on your screen at home. Would you dial that number? There's someone here at Cornerstone would love to just say, God bless you. Thank you for your decision for Jesus today. If you're here this morning, there's some of you just prayed that prayer in your heart, and God bless you, friend. Jesus said, if you'll confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me before men, I'll deny you. Here's your opportunity to make a stand for Jesus. As heads are bowed and eyes are closed, if you pray that prayer this morning, right where you're at, would you raise your hand? Raise it high. Anybody here? God bless you, ma'am. Anybody else? God bless you, young man. Anybody else? Say yes to Jesus today. Greatest sin you'll ever make. There's some of you need a church home. Been praying you're Christians, live in this area, or whether you don't live in it. We got people who drive all the way from Sherman here Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. For Melissa, I'm over outside of Louisville. Church Alive is worth the drive. Say amen to that. If God's brought you here, you need a church home, we'd love to have you. We have counselors up here who'd love to greet you and welcome you to the family. Some of us need to hit the altar and just thank Jesus again for that great getting up morning. Thank God for that great getting up morning. We have something to look forward to. We have a hope the world didn't give us, and that grave can't take away. A lot to be thankful for, church. You need to come this morning. You come as we sing.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. So we pray.